Conspiracy TV live on Comcast Channel 22 or Verizon Channel 33. In the background recording. Couple things, orders of business tonight. First, I don't know if anybody noticed, but yesterday we had a storm. And we are in a deficit position on the snow and ice budget already. You should have a memo in front of you from the Finance Committee to Town Accountant and Board of Selectmen. And I think Sharon, am I supposed to read it?
Yeah, you just have to read the motion and hold on to put it back.
Okay. Dated March 9th, dated March 15th.
Yeah, the deficit's been announced.
Okay, so I'm going to just read it, we'll get our dates right. And then we'll need a motion to approve.
I think the amount is equal to the date that he puts in the motion.
Yeah. Okay, we'll shift it. So pursuant to Chapter 44, Section 31D of the Massachusetts General Law, this is Bob writing, by the way, I am hereby approving incurring of liability and making expenditure in FY 2017 excess of available appropriations for snow and ice removal, subject to approval by the Finance Committee. It's my intent, as we have in past years, to amend the snow and ice budget at the annual town meeting and therefore be able to rescind this action. Sincerely, Robert W. Lalasher, Jr., CFA Town Manager. I have a motion to approve.
So moved.
Have a second?
Second.
Any discussion on this? No? All right. All those in favor? Opposed? And we are 8-0? On this one? I think we're 8-0.
We're going to pay for plowing.
All right. We are 9-0. Okay. You're good. Okay, next order of business tonight is review of the school committee budget. Hopefully everybody has their little books or iPads, even better. John, you're over here.
Oh, yeah.
I'm looking down, saying, that changed. You're going to make a bit of a short presentation and go to questions? Is that our goal for tonight?
Yeah, I'm going to make a presentation, and yes, then the rest of the time there will be questions, if that's okay.
Great, thank you.
So as you said, because I know the last time we were here, we were having discussions about a proposal that the town manager had put forward, and we also had the school committee budget, which the school committee had voted on. And I've asked the question many times, what we are presenting tonight is the school committee budget. I do have a slide at the end that talks about the differences between the two, both the town manager proposal and the school committee budget. Because I know I'm sure it's going to be questions about that tonight. But
great.
My understanding is tonight we are presenting the school committee budget. So that's what you're going to see for the numbers and all of the information that's going to be presented to you. And the budget book that you have in front of you is the school committee budget.
Great. Thank you.
Okay. And then everyone should have received the answers to the questions. I want to thank Gail for all the work that she did in putting these answers together and getting them out to you in a timely manner. What I'm going to do this evening is I'm going to take a look at this probably more at a 30,000 foot level, but also talk about some things that I know have come up in some of the questions and in other conversations to hopefully clarify some things. And Gail is also going to, any time that I miss something, she's going to be right there because she's very good with the numbers. So the first thing I want to talk about is this is not the first year that we've had budget reductions, and you've probably seen some format of this slide before. In that we've actually had several years of budget reductions. And so you could see here a snapshot of the amount of teacher FTE reductions, other staff FTE reductions, the amount of funding of personnel and non-personnel and offset increases over the last several years. So you can see that there has had to be changes in our budget each year from the level service budget from the previous year. So in essence, we keep eroding away at the level service budget that originally started in FY 13. So what we're talking about now is that the reductions that we are making are significant reductions that are now affecting, they've always affected what we've been doing, but now we're at a point where we're teetering on being able to function as a school district K to 12. And that's what we're dealing with at this point. Here's a breakdown of the reductions by specificity in terms of personnel, non-personnel, over the last several fiscal years. So this breaks it down in more detail from the previous slide. What we have tried to do over the years, as much as possible, is to stay away from the classroom until the last couple of years, and we've had to, because there hasn't been any other areas to reduce.
I just had a little comment. I just was looking at that other slide, which I've seen a few times. But I wonder if we should say level service budget reductions, because someone looking at that might say, oh, wow, we've been cutting the budget.
I see what you're saying. Yep.
It's a little tweak,
yep.
But I think it clarifies.
It's a good point. Thank you. I know one of the questions that's come up, and the numbers are in our budget book, but we've not really turned it into a percentage, and I think it's powerful to see the percentage ranging from FY10 until this past fiscal year is the funding that we do turn back at the end of the year that goes to free cash. And when you're talking about a $36 million budget or upwards to a $40 million budget and the percentage that we're turning back each year, I think the point we're trying to make here is that the funding that is approved by town meeting is managed well. We do what we can with the funding that we receive, and that we've always been able to manage it in a way that we are turning back, except for one year, and that was because we over-budgeted unanticipated special ed tuition. We've stayed under 1% of our total budget that we've turned back. And so what the funding that we have always received, we've always managed as to the best of our ability to provide the best education with the resources we have available to the students of Reading. So we've never done it in a percentage. We've always just shown it as a chart in the budget book as the amount of funding that we've returned back. But I think it's important to see that what we're talking about when we return funding back is that it's, except for one year, less than 1%. The drivers for the FY18 budget is all of the salary and benefit obligations per collective bargaining. We have just begun collective bargaining with all five collective bargaining units. The teachers being the largest of the five. Non-union and salary benefit increases, which are in line with COLA adjustments. We do have some increases in mandatory regular day transportation. You will also see in some upcoming slides some decreases in offsets for athletics, extracurricular, use of school properties, and kindergarten, although it is then offset with an increase in kindergarten tuition, because one of the decisions that the school committee made was to put back the regular education paraeducators, which required an increase in the tuition. I think it's important to note that one of the things that we have been focusing on since the audit report came out 2-3 years ago now on the revolving accounts,
3 years
ago, is to use a sustainable model for what we use for offsets. And so this year we did have to make some corrections with that, which resulted in decreases in some of our offsets, which did contribute to part of the reduction that we had to make overall through the budget. But we felt long term this was the best thing to do financially. We also saw an increase in some athletic expenses, particularly in transportation and pool rental. And we did see a decrease in the offset for the METCO grant. So these were the major drivers for the budget that I first presented to the school committee, and then the school committee eventually made some changes and voted on. When we're developing the budget, I do want to take a couple minutes to talk about this, because I think it's important, because I think sometimes there's some misperceptions and some clarity is needed as we're developing this budget. We develop our budget in the November prior to the start of the fiscal year. And when we're developing that budget, obviously where 83% of our budget is salary, we need to make some assumptions with salaries. And what we do is we are using the actual salaries of the employees that are there in November to develop the budget. So we all, if there's a employees that we know are on leave of absence, we use their salaries and not the salary of the person that's currently in. If it's an employee that we know is retiring, we do use their salary because we do not know who is coming in to replace that person. And more times than not, depending on the position, we're not necessarily getting a lot of savings with the next person coming in. When a person is hired by the Reading Public Schools, they don't automatically start at the first step of the salary scale. They start, which is commensurate with their levels of experience. And that's common practice in education. We also, as we're building in our budget, we're reviewing students who potentially need additional special education services. Carolyn Wilson and Gail Dowd literally go student by student, and they look to see potentially which students could require additional special education services. Sometimes that can be accomplished in district. Sometimes it has to be out of district. And we do budget a certain amount for those assumptions. We also use other known contractual costs. So for example, if we have a transportation contract, which we are, I believe, in the second year of, we know those costs for next year, we build those in. Tuition, we build in a certain percentage for tuition for special education. With the public collaboratives, usually it's around a 3% increase. With the private, it's not. A lot of times it's a crapshoot, because every 6 years they can go to a special bureau and request for a much higher percentage increase that we don't have a lot of control over. So we do make certain assumptions with tuition increases for particularly for private tuitions, but we're not always on top. We're not always accurate. Athletic facility rentals, we make assumptions with those, and technology services. As we move more and more to automation, you do save in costs of personnel, but you also have to pay more of ongoing fees to do that automation. We also have to budget other known additional costs. So for example, this year we had to add some additional special education staff at Wood End and Joshua Eaton. That was built into next year's budget. Those are driven by students' IEPs. So when we're developing a budget, these are the types of assumptions that we have to build in. Knowing, though, that a lot of things can happen from November of 2016 to when school opens in September of 2017. Because essence, that's really when our budget begins. Even though July 1 is the official start of the fiscal year, when the doors open is really when our budget starts moving forward, because that's when most of the hiring is now done. There are also some variances that impact the budget during the year that are not budgeted for, that are unpredictable. Staff turnover is one. When a staff member leaves, sometimes they leave at the end of the school year, sometimes they leave in the middle of the school year. Obviously that has an impact on your budget. Sometimes it's financially a positive impact, other times it's not. You can't predict that in November. When staff FTE are transferred from one school to another, it may not have necessarily have a budget impact, but it shows up in the budget book as a transfer of FTE from one school to another. So for example, this year you'll notice a difference between FY17 and FY18 for a special education staff at Coolidge, one FTE less at Coolidge, or at middle school, I believe it says, high school has an additional FTE. We didn't add an FTE in the budget. We transferred an FTE from middle school to high school. A lot of this, these types of things happen all the time. Some of them have an impact on the budget, some do not. a change in the DESE classification, and this is something that sometimes happens when there is a position in our district that is fulfilling a certain role according to the department, and then maybe their role changes a little bit, and sometimes an example is technology. This year, we need to change the classification. It doesn't mean an increase in FTE. It means shifting the pieces of that FTE from one place to another in the budget. Again, not a change in budget cost, but it looks like that we've added a position, but if you look carefully enough, there's an increase in one area, but a decrease in another area. That happens all the time. And we are driven by the type of data that DESE is asking for and the job that they are each staff member is doing. Unanticipated special education out-of-district placements. Sometimes we have students that either move in and from another community, and if it's prior to, I believe, April, we bear the cost of that tuition. Sometimes we have a student that we haven't predicted is going to go on an out-of-district placement, and we have not budgeted for, and that is something that is not built in the budget. And then we have staff on leave, and this happens a lot. We have staff that go on maternity leave. We have staff that go on leave of absences for other reasons, and sometimes we are able to bring in a long-term sub, which is at a lower rate. However, sometimes we can't do that, and we're actually carrying two salaries. So for example, this past year, we had an administrator at one of our schools that was out, crossed two fiscal years. That person was out, had the appropriate sick time, so we were carrying that position's that person's salary, and we had to hire a replacement at a comparable salary. So we were carrying two salaries for that position. It is not something that we anticipated when we developed that budget in November of the previous fiscal year. We have currently some situations in our district school psychologists where we have some school psychologists out on leave. It's very difficult to try to find a school psychologist mid-year. So sometimes what we have to do is we have to pay a person to do the counseling portion of being a school psychologist, and then we have to hire another person to come in and do all of the special education testing, which is required and mandated. So and then you're carrying the salary of the school psychologist. So you're actually, it's we call it triple dipping. There's actually three salaries that we have to account for at one time. These are things that we don't budget for, because you can't anticipate these, but they do happen. Some variance like this happens every year in our budget.
And you're assuming the same variance every year based on when you build it?
We do build in our budget a number of long-term subs for maternity leave. That is something we do build in. But we do not build in a lot of the things that I've mentioned here.
Oh, so it's not built off of previous year assumptions?
No.
For some of these, that could be one-off situations, especially for some of the, it could be with the administrator, unknown that it would cross two fiscal years, so it wouldn't have been something we would have said, well, budget for two, and then the school psychologist came up this year where would not have thought that we would actually need to go and get two people to fill in for the one. If it's a known, we'll make sure we're looking at the long-term substitute line to say we know we have X number of. I think the other part that's a little bit tougher is because we're doing it in November, we may not, and it's going all the way, I don't know who is or is not going to necessarily have a child, because that's outside of the time.
Right.
I'm going to say this without getting, so if we know, I'm going to get in trouble. But if we know of some, and that's why we have the long-term stuff, because we know there will be a percent of the population, but to really say, it'll be three, it'll be five, we could have a larger percentage, but because of how far in advance we're doing it, I can't count the number that will actually occur. But we do look at the long-term sub rate. We do, that's why you saw, we did make some adjustments in the substitute and long-term substitute line, because I went back and said, okay, historically, what have we done? What have we seen in the past couple of years? Some years, bigger population, but we did right size a lot of those lines to say, historically, this is what we're doing. So a lot of the bottoms up approach we took this year was really looking at trends, how much have we seen, and to try to capture it in the right line items.
So some of these charts you've seen before, it's just to summarize the reductions. So the first is the decreases in the offsets. So athletics, and some of this, as I said before, was to become more sustainable with our revolving accounts. Athletics, it was a decrease of $96,000, but you will see that in another slide, we did increase the athletic fee, so that's actually a smaller amount. Full-day kindergarten, $50,000, you will see that is actually a net of zero because we increased, the school committee voted to increase the tuition to bring back the regular education paraeducators. Use of school properties is a decrease of $60,000, extracurricular $7,000, and the METCO grant is $40,000. So all of this has an impact, certainly on the budget and the reduction that we had to make this year. Here is the personnel reductions. Again, remember, this is the school committee budget. We did make reduction in administration, the school business assistant. It was a position that we made a decision not to fill when the person left last year. Given the fact that we knew that there was an override coming up in October, we chose not to fill it because we knew that this position probably would not get filled and it would be one of our reductions if the override was not successful. We did reduce two elementary classroom teachers, but because of an enrollment change, we did not have to fill these two positions. So it is still a reduction, because if enrollment changed, we would have to go back and take a look at it. At the elementary level, we will not have to lay off any current teachers because of this. The 3.8 high school teachers is a combination of art, physical education, and business, and another 1.4 of it is FTE in science, social studies, and language arts. Supervisor of students is a high school position. Technician is a district-wide position. The 0.6 rise preschool teacher is a music position. Instructional coach is our mathematics instructional coach. The 0.5 special education administrator is a team chair position, and this brings it up to the 10.9 FTE. What is not here are the 7 middle school teachers, which the school committee, as you know, in their budget is advocating for additional use of free cash to bring those 7 positions back. We also had some non-personnel reductions. Cleaning services are getting reduced at the high school. And so you can see that amount, the $80,000. We are decreasing our technology, hardware, and computer services by $35,000. That is because we do have an amount in the capital plan next year for, I believe, $100,000. So we did see this as redundancy, so we made that reduction. And then some professional development expenses in regular day and special ed, and some science kit coordination. So there's your non-personnel reductions. And then this is some user fee increases. So athletics, we have an increase in user fee. RISE, we have an increase in RISE tuition of 5%. Regular day kindergarten tuition is also increased. So there's your amount for that. When you put all these together, you have the final amount for the school committee budget, which is $41,889,661. Or a 2.8% increase. What is also in this budget is the $150,000 for science, which in the town manager's proposal, that is going to be addressed in FY17. So I didn't want to confuse people, but the school committee voted the $150,000 as part of their budget for FY18. Town manager's proposal is looking at the $150,000 for science to be decided upon for FY17. A at town meeting where the durable goods and materials would be purchased prior to the end of this fiscal year. So there's a difference there as well.
Yep. Let me just add to that, in the town warrant that's now been approved by the selectmen, there is, I forget exactly where it is, but there is what John just said specifically. In that fiscal 17 budget, a request for the $150,000 out of FY 17 funds. So we're, this is all the 18 budget. That's suggested to be addressed in FY 17 so it can be ready in time for the school year.
Correct. Is that the second or third year on that?
Second.
Okay.
Of three. Right.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
The percent changes are consistent to what I was just presenting to you. It's a combination of, depending on the cost center, of personnel reductions, increases in offsets, decreases in offsets, and depending on, and the different adjustments on the budget drivers that I mentioned earlier, to get to the 2.8%. There are some additions to the FY18 budget. They all are special education additions. The 0.5 special education team chair, we increased the Joshua Eaton team chair to full-time to provide more support for Joshua Eaton. There was a special education teacher that was added this year for Wood End, which is continuing in next year's budget, and a special education teacher at Joshua Eaton, which was hired this year and is continuing next year's budget. So those are the additional positions. And those are all driven, the two teachers are driven by IEP needs, student IEP needs. When you take a look at the budget, salaries versus expenses, and sorry for the small print, you see the grand total on the left and how it's broken down by professional salaries, clerical salaries, etc. When you take a look at the total salaries make up 83% of our budget. Other expenses make up 17%. I believe that percentage is much different in the town budget. It's probably more of a 50-50 split. We're obviously a very personnel-driven industry, education. So when you're trying to make reductions, and most of your expenses are mandated or required, you really don't have too many places to go other than salaries. You can see the breakdown between represented and non-represented. So most of that 83% is represented salaries. Your non-represented are mainly administrators and some other positions. But you can see by cost center the expenses, so these are non-personnel. In those expenses, by cost center, in administration, you have things that are pretty much required, either legally or just because it's an essential function of the job. You have legal costs, audit, employee physicals, recruiting expenses, photocopy, things like that. On the regular day, you have all of your teaching and learning materials, including professional development, technology, mandated transportation. Special education pretty much is all mandated and required by law, the expense part. Your district-wide includes health, which is primarily nurses, the nurses' salaries, extracurricular activities and athletics, technology infrastructure. And then facilities is your contracted cleaning services and supplies. So you can see that out of those expenses, a lot of them are things that you really can't cut any more than we've already reduced. So again, you're relegated back to looking at personnel reductions. I want to talk a little bit about risks. And this is something that actually came out of a suggestion that Ms. Borowski made when we were going through the litigation, that one of the things that we wanted to make sure of in the future is to make the committee, but also the community, aware of risks with anything that we are doing with our budget financially. So Gail has done a great job every time something comes up, keeping track of this is a potential risk. So I want to quickly, and some of it I've already mentioned, but I want to talk about some of the things that are risks involved with this FY18 budget that we don't have a lot of control over. So one is grant state federal funding, okay? We do receive a significant amount of grant and state and federal funding in our budget, whether it be the IDA grant, the school transformation grant, Title I, Title IIA. These are all grants that help support the operating budget. We know that federal and state funding can change from year to year. And the state budget, you know, we've talked about in the past, the Chapter 70 funding, and how that's always, and for Reading's perspective, it has not increased that much over the last few years, because the formula is not advantageous to Reading. Federal funding, we're seeing right now that there are significant cuts being proposed to the federal education budget. I don't think they'll all come to fruition, but there will be some reduction at the federal level that will have an impact on school budgets across the country. You do have always the possibility of 9C cuts. If state budget revenues are not coming in at the level of the expenses that are going out, this happened in, I believe, 2009. One of the areas that they looked at was circuit breaker when they did that. Fortunately, the way that we've set it up is we do have budget certainty with circuit breaker because we are using the previous year's circuit breaker. And this is something that a lot of communities are starting to try to do, and we've been able to do it. That, you know, our circuit breaker, if something happens this year with circuit breaker, we've got a year to fix it. So that's one area that we are okay with. But these are some of the risks in terms of that. Leaves of absences I've already talked about. This is something that we don't have a lot of control over. Special education I already talked about as a risk. Changing in staffing needs, I already referred to. Particularly this happens in special education when we have a need to increase because of a child's IEP. These are items that are not budgeted for, and we sometimes have to use existing funding to make it work. And then, as I mentioned, also special education. This is an area that changes throughout the year. Homeless population, this is something that in foster care. These are things that are now starting to emerge across our Commonwealth, and that there is, with homeless, it's the transportation costs. We do get partial reimbursement from the state for homeless transportation. We do have some students in Reading that are designated as homeless. And I know that Carolyn and Gail have recently received guidance on the foster care piece, and also transportation as well is a cost. And right now, I don't believe, there is no reimbursement on this. And we do have some students that are in foster care in our district. The level three piece of Joshua Eaton, we are working very hard with staff at Joshua Eaton at district level and at the building level to put things in place for curriculum work, professional development, training, additional resources. These are things that we have not budgeted. And so what we try to do is we try to shift expenses around. We make decisions during the school year if we have to, because obviously this is a priority, is to move Josh Reaton in a direction where they are no longer at the level three designation. Some other things that are risks are contract and services renewal. One of the things that we need to negotiate this year are copier leases. Our copier leases are coming to an end. So this is something that, and copiers are something that are an essential function of all of our schools. Unanticipated changes in enrollment is another risk that we always look at. And right now, our enrollment is pretty much stayed steady. Our kindergarten enrollment is, we believe, in a good place. Sometimes, though, we do see some spikes during the summer in enrollment. And these are things that we have to be prepared to address. And here's some things that are also, they're risks. And we call it sometimes the hit by the bus theory, that if some, you know, something happens to one of us, we don't really have a succession plan in central office to what happens if somebody is not able to carry out the functions for a while. So we do have some support on the town side in areas, for example, we do have a network manager on the town side, we have a network manager on the school side. And I know last year when we were in transition with our director of finance, Gail, Sharon helped out with Munis-related activities. But we do not have a lot of redundancy, and that is a concern as we move forward. The reduction of that school business assistant position is a position that this a lot of that redundancy would have happened, where that person would have been cross-trained in a variety of areas. Something that recently just changed is the public records law. So Carolyn and I have a new title. We are public records access officers, and we received our training from Laura. But these are the types of things that, you know, it's that regulatory environment that happens occasionally at the state and federal level that creates additional workload for existing personnel. And you can't just create a new position and expect that you know, that person's going to do the work. So it's spread out as best we can, but a lot of times it's you know, moved to people that are already doing other numerous duties. There is limited funding available for professional development, which is going to limit our ability to achieve our district goals. And one that has emerged recently is Coolidge class sizes in grade 6 next year are going to be 30 students in each class. Parker's are going to be 24, 25, and Coolidge's are going to be 30, and that just fell as a result of the redistricting lines. Once in a while, this does happen at the middle school level. So that is something we've got to keep an eye on. And there is no additional staffing right now assigned to Coolidge to address those class sizes. So I didn't know if you wanted to stop here or...
Are there any questions? Why don't we take a quick
breath? I know I've just thrown a lot
breath. Any questions on what we've covered so far?
Yeah, actually, not to jump all the way back to the beginning, but I like the slide a lot where you showed the percentage in terms of over. And I can't remember, I know, well, first off, thank you for all of the feedback on the responses and everything. And I just didn't have the question in mind when I saw all of that. So I don't think it was answered. But to your point earlier, right, with that one exception, you stayed within the 1%, which to me shows great discipline in forming the budget and adhering to it. So it certainly gives me more comfort as we look at things, that what is put down on the budget is what will actually come through. But I'm trying to remember, and one that comes to mind, was it last year or the year before? I think we had was it a boiler or something in one of the schools that needed to be replaced. And that I honestly can't remember how that fell in the budget. But how do one-offs like that, where we have to come back and maybe ask for additional money during the year, play into that, you know, plus or minus, or really minus in all of those cases, the 1%? And would that skew anything, or am I thinking of it the wrong way?
The boiler example, that I believe we went back to town meeting for the reason, or did we come to the finance committee for reserve fund?
Yeah, I'm trying. Yeah. That's why I couldn't quite remember the details. Yeah.
Yeah, that's a capital.
Okay, so right. So are there other things that have happened over those last couple of years? Great, that one doesn't count. That was just kind of what started me down that path, where we've said, okay, outside of those numbers there, we had to ask for something special, and what we asked for is what we spent, so that was fine. I'm not saying one way or the other, but would it skew those numbers, or that truly was kind of the all-in number in that?
That is the amount we returned versus the total budget that was approved by town meeting.
I don't think you asked for a lot of money.
No, I can't remember any of them.
We have not
come
back. No, I mean, the boiler, that's an extraordinary circumstance.
Not one that I worried about, it just that's what got me down that path, was I couldn't remember have there been anything.
Back in the old days before accommodated costs.
Yep.
For the scene.
Okay. All right, that makes sense.
Out of district placements, but that's corrected that.
Got it.
I can remember being asked at a town meeting where curriculum, like we're doing.
Yeah, yeah.
Right, that's just right.
Yeah, just.
At a town meeting.
I liked that slide, so it just got me thinking that, okay, is there something we should think about or adjust for?
If there was something added, it's definitely in there because the numbers would have come from me for cash, so it would be every change. I should have footnoted that all in there very closely on, so if there was a transfer in.
No, I think it's a great slide to show to people because it shows discipline of forming and spending, that, hey, this is what we tell you the budget is, you know, we're adhering to it and, you know, slightly conservative, but okay.
Are there questions, comments? Nope. You're going to the next step?
So, yeah, I just got a couple more slides and then we can open it up. So, there's always been a lot of question also about the per pupil building budget. So, and I just want to spend a little bit of time to talk about this. First of all, you could see from FY11 to FY18. It's actually gone down. The building budget, the per pupil allocation, is the amount of funding that we allocate to each school based on the number of students that they have from October 1 enrollment that they use for their day-to-day operations. So their copier leases, any consumable curriculum material, paper, pencils, all of their day-to-day supplies, that is all purchased through those building-based allocations. So you could see a graduation at the high school. So you could see that with the exception of the years that we purposely decreased it to offset reductions in our budget, it's pretty much stayed the same within a few thousand dollars. We had to do this year, I already said. So here's all the things that the building-based budgets fund. And you can see this is all the day-to-day supplies. Occasionally you will see in a building-based budget some funding for classroom furniture. It may be for a replacement desk, something like that, that the building principal knows that he or she is gonna need the following year. Some technology, you can see software, things like that. What we had to do this year, because we knew that the grade 3 to 5 science curriculum was going to have an ongoing expense, is we had to reallocate the expenses so that we would not increase this line item. We knew that we were going to have a difficult budget year, we were going to have to make some difficult decisions, and our goal was to keep this pretty much the same. You can see that it's within $146. So what we did is we reallocated the funding from primarily the high school to the middle and the elementary schools so that the elementary schools could sustain the NOADA program, which is a consumable-driven program. Any strong science program is consumable driven and has a greater expense. We used historical spending to see what adjustments we could make. So that's why you see a difference here. I know that was one of the questions.
And we did work very closely with all of the building principals when we did this. We actually, before we finalized the numbers and the allocations, we actually met individually and as a group with it. So everyone was aware of the shift, especially at the high school, and we worked very closely with them to make sure the thought process we put into it, everybody was comfortable. So it definitely was a collaborative process. As much as we came up with the numbers and presented, we did make sure we had buy-in that the shifts we were making were enough to cover what we were looking to cover with it.
Does that bring up high school more in line with history, or is there...
So I think that's Yeah, the last slide I just want to show you, because I know we had some conversation the last time, is the comparison of the school committee budget with the town manager proposal. So the school committee budget requires the use of $438,000 of free cash to restore the 7.0 FTE positions. It requires the use of $150,000 of free cash for the science implementation for year two. The town manager's proposal, as I mentioned earlier, $150,000 for science implementation being proposed at April town meeting for FY17. The seven FTE middle school positions are restored in the original budget. The school department must submit a balanced budget to the town manager that includes the seven FTE positions. And it's assumed that town and school budget savings throughout the fiscal year will help offset the seven FTEs. If that does not come to fruition, then the school department will request additional funding at town meeting next year. Those are the comparisons between the two proposals. So I believe that's my last slide. Yes. So I guess at this point we'll just open it up to.
Actually, one question on this slide. The third point, school department must submit a balanced budget to town manager that includes 7.0 FTE positions.
Yes.
I think that's something we all need to work through and understand well. Do you have a notion of how to achieve that?
How to show that? What is that?
What is a balanced budget that includes those seven?
So that it's a balanced budget that equals the funding that's been allocated. So line by line, things would need to come up to that bottom line.
The bottom line
that
we see here?
The bottom line that was approved by, that was the guidance given to us by the Finance Committee in November.
Got it. Okay, so then it would be, sorry, that 40 million number less 438?
Yes.
Okay. So that's, and then the proviso that goes with that is that any town and school budget savings throughout the fiscal year will help to offset that.
So we would make adjustments to our budget.
Got it.
If during the fiscal year we're not able to reach those adjustments, then during next year, I know the town manager mentioned that there was some savings on the town side that he could hold back some purchases, that if we were not able to come up with the 438, then the remainder would be requested at town meeting.
So there'll be a budget. So this is 41889661 is what's here. There'll be a 41.
So
four,
be minus,
whatever.
It would actually be minus 538. The school committee budget.
Oh, right, because that included the 150. Okay.
The
150 and the 438.
Yeah, 588.
Okay, so that's the one that'll be great. Okay, questions from the committee?
I have a question actually about not budgeting for additional supports for Joshua Eaton, but expecting to need to supply them and to do so from other existing resources within the district. Is that, how does that make sense? Why doesn't it make sense to budget specifically for services you know will be needed to be provided?
We don't know what those services look like.
Okay.
I mean, this past year, we were not aware when we first budgeted that we were going to require an additional special education teacher. We also didn't realize when we were budgeting in November that they were going to require some additional administrative support. Primarily in special education. So those two things emerged during the year. I could not, in good conscience, wait until next year to put those things in place. And we did have some savings in other areas and reallocated the funding to those.
Oh, okay, so this is looking back at that time.
Yes.
Sorry,
okay.
The example was
it
looking
was
backwards.
Okay.
Yeah,
they
didn't
specific for this
yes.
year, so
okay.
The items for Joshua Eaton came up during the year. So, in my
so
mind,
for
like, here's an actual example of what transpired in the current fiscal year. All of that in the known items we have related to them are in the 18 budget.
We built it in
17.
Yes.
Okay, thanks.
But we didn't have it in 17.
I missed that. Thank you. No, I was trying to say, here's some historical examples, items that last November, but fast forward to this November.
Got it.
And you know, and we actually did build those in to next year as a known item.
Got it, thank you.
And that being an example of, you realize some savings.
Yes.
So we're able to afford that one FTE.
So when we're going through for one of the other items, which can be, it's a risk, and it's a risk that sort of can cut both ways, is in the hiring, where we may have been able to hire people at a different rate than the exiting departed person.
Mm-hmm.
So there are instances we've been tracking it. I've started looking at it to say, okay, how are we doing? We've had other instances where a person went out at this step and the person came in at exactly the same step. We've had other instances where a person has left and we've hired somebody, which is a great, we've hired a more experienced person at a higher step. We've had some where we've hired low. So it really depends how many and where.
So I was thinking, maybe I'm misremembering, but I thought it was on a slide that was headed with FY18 budget risks. So
that was how it was.
Yeah, I was giving an example of what has happened this year.
Okay.
That could happen next year.
Mm-hmm.
We don't know.
All right. Thank you.
Vanessa, did you have some questions?
Why did you see me writing things down? So I know the town manager, when he presented his budget, had several items that have asterisks by them saying these are holdbacks for these 7 FTEs. Does the school have certain savings that it's anticipating over the school year?
So I'm going to go on assumptions right now, because it's more historical than anything else. So, and Gail already alludes to the fact that we've started tracking FY18 purchases, but hirings and maybe some contracts that, not personnel contracts, but other for contracted services, things like that we've already know are going to be known costs next year that we may have budgeted differently. So we have some retirements that we know of. So, you know, you make an assumption that you'll be able to get some savings from those retirements. We've been doing this for as long as I've been here. We always hold back 30% of those per pupil
building-based
budgets that I just mentioned, and we release that in mid-April each year. We may be able, if we can front load that this year, we can cut that next year. It's more of an accounting shift for next year, but if we're able to have enough savings in this fiscal year that we can give them additional building based funding now so that they can pre-purchase what they would be doing next year, we could cut that piece next year.
That would be within the budget that we
currently
have,
right.
Where we go
instead
through, we're in the process
back
of doing
cash,
a really deep updating the forecast now, and that'll be looking at, okay, what have we had salary savings? You might have savings if you have had a position open where the long-term subs are less than the person that was here, or some of your hiring differences, some of our other contract services. We go through line by line and say, okay, where are we? Where do we think we're going to be? Do we have any extra funding that when we present our updates, we say, okay, here's where we are, and we can look to say we have some that we can go ahead and utilize that money towards some of the curriculum and some of the consumables.
Yeah, good. So, sure.
Essentially means less being repatriated to free cash at the end of the year.
So fiscal 17.
You said that you thought there might be some savings because of anticipated retirements, but I thought you had said earlier that you usually budget for a new hire to come in at the same.
No, we budget retirements at the salary of the retiree, because we do not know who's coming in.
Right. So weren't you just saying now, though, that you thought we might
based
be able to?
Based upon what we've seen transpire, based upon some of the known retirements and where we think replacements will come in.
Right.
Okay.
We've already hired some people for next year
because
of the retirements.
Okay.
So we.
Got it. So that's no, no quantities. Okay.
Right, exactly.
We've been starting to track.
Got it.
Left, I came in.
Got it.
How did we?
Okay.
Yeah.
How did we do? So we've started to track.
Okay.
Each item and even some of the said where we've had licensing agreements where we're like, oh, we did this. Oh, look, there's $500. So we've started to line item by line item, hire by hire.
Now, I don't know if this is where you're going, but we do not have enough savings for the 438 or 530, 588 or whatever the number is. No, we don't have that at this point.
Do you have an estimate of what those savings are anticipated to be? A range, perhaps?
I think what's so difficult is so much of your budget salaries.
Yeah, we haven't even started the fiscal year yet.
Yeah, so
a lot of our hiring happens.
The big hiring starts
summer,
in the summer.
So it's tough to say right now where we think some of those are.
I'm trying to, you know, we have a hard number from the town side, so we know what that is. I'm trying to gauge, are we talking 25 to 50,000 estimated, or are we up in the 200,000? It's difficult when we talk about the 588 coming from free cash.
I think the hard part is that on the town side, there are fixed costs that exist now that are easily predicted. It's a police car. It's a painting project. It's more than a painting project, but it's a contracting. It's actually two contracting projects. That's the bulk of that number.
We can hold back some expenses. We can't hold back a lot of expenses. We can hold back some expenses in technology purchases. The risk to that, though, is that when you have aging computers, it's going to have an impact on the classroom. And we've been trying to get in a cycle of replenishment. We have $100,000 that's budgeted for technology replenishment.
That we can.
We can hold that, but it's going to come at an expense for the classroom.
And we were very fortunate. We had a very generous donation last year, if I remember.
Yes.
So we were able to utilize that before. So any time we're fortunate to receive donations from the PTOs, we always utilize the donations first to preserve as much. So we can't bank on it, but that is an area where even this year we monitor that throughout the year, and that's one of the areas we sort of put a hold on until we're comfortable with where we are to say, okay, this is how much did Julian's decide?
Right.
That's what I've done for the past month. I'm like, here's how much you can have. So that is one of the areas, but it is with a lot of the testing that's done on the computers now, it gets to be a little bit of it. We have to make sure we're set up for the students to do the testing, so it is a...
All of the MCAS now in grades 3 through 8, except for science, is online.
I guess I had a comment here.
Dr. Gordon said it. I just wanted to make it clear that back 10, 20 years ago, technology in the classroom was predominantly for instruction, which is wonderful. But it is important to know that we're moving into an environment where the standardized tests will be given online. They have been in the past, and the state's clearly moving in that direction. It's no longer now a nice to have, it is an absolute essential.
I'm sorry, Eric, didn't need to interrupt.
No, I guess at a high level, Mr. Robinson made the comment that it would be less, you're able to find this throughout the course of the year, it's less that is repatriated to free cash at the end of the year. At the same time, we saw your previous slide where you're usually right on the money, no pun intended. And so there hasn't been much wiggle room in previous years. And I'm just trying to reconcile those two ideas, I guess. And
Chuck behind you. Go ahead.
Just to clarify, when I said that, I was referring to the per pupil accounts, to the extent that they can identify what consumables can be purchased before next year.
Got it.
Yes,
it's exactly right. Yes.
So I wasn't saying there are other things in the budget that would be necessarily, I was talking more relative to the per pupil.
Understand. I didn't mean to use your comment out of context.
I just wanted to make sure you
understand. I think the point still applies. This, these funds that, if you find them, would go toward this, would otherwise potentially go to free cash or be reallocated elsewhere.
Exactly. I mean, and I think the history has shown that we're going to be very tight on our management of expenses, and you know, we're going to do everything we can. But we're not in a place at this point where I can't identify $438,000.
If I could add to that, I know many of you came to school committee meetings in January. I think a process that many individual school committee members went through, I certainly went through, because there was such concern about those middle school positions, we looked for places in the budget to find $400,000 that wasn't what Dr. Doherty and his staff came up with. And it is important to point out that he worked very collaboratively with the principals. He didn't do this in his office on his own. The administrative team came together and said, how are we going to cut $1.4 million from level service and the least bad impact on students? So I won't go into the details, but certainly several school committee members made a tremendously good faith effort to try to find $400,000 of different cuts, and none of us were successful. None of us were even remotely successful. Remotely, we couldn't get close to $400,000. I just wanted to make that statement.
And I think just to add to that comment, one of the questions we need to deal with is there isn't a bucket for 438. I think we're all in agreement. Mm-hmm. There's not a way to do that. Yeah. But are there ways that we can chip away at that number? Are there different sources that can do it? So one piece is the holdbacks that the town has suggested already. So that $132,000, that's one piece of it. Another piece that we should talk about tonight is we had authorized up to $1.2 million in free cash to be used to support the operating budget, but the current operating budget only uses $1.1 million. There were other sources that came in, but 1.2 is what we talked about, 1.1 is what's currently being used. So that's a discussion point. You know, there may be some other pieces also. You know, hopefully there is something, and Paul and I were talking about in the background, sorry, was that if you look even at the last couple of years, there has been money that's floated back into the general fund, into free cash at year end. Not predicted or predictable at the start of the year, but it comes back at the end. So at some point, we're going to have a discussion about what risks, and we had a couple pages of them, but what risks we're willing to accept. When we look at health insurance, we accept a risk, we put in a number, and we accept a risk that the real number might be different, and that we will recommend the use of free cash to take care of any difference if it's unfavorable. Turns out we got a number, and it turns out it worked out better. State aid, however, was in the other direction. Again, we make an assumption as to what it's going to be to allow all these budgets to go forward. So one of the things we'll be able to think about is how much risk is reasonable to assume in this budget. Is it reasonable to assume that between what the town is suggesting they'll hold back and different activities that may happen on the school side from not spending certain things or turnover or other activities, that some of that money will come back in? And how much of that are we willing to talk about in terms of the budget to town meeting? Or we could decide that we should recommend more free cash or not. And those are kind of the parameters we have to play inside and decide what we can get. And I take Vanessa's point, we're trying to identify as many of them as we can now and whittle that number down. So it doesn't look like 438, it looks like, you know, 200 or whatever the number is going to turn out to be. And then assess what level of risk makes sense and support that to the town. So sorry for going on. Sorry, someone had a comment. David?
I had a quick question. I was looking on the benchmarking data, and on page 34. So interestingly, when it comes to professional development, Reading is first, but then, you know, when you look at it in total, we're 10th, and I mean, it kind of seems very skewed. I mean, it's,
yes.
And I tried to read the narrative, and unfortunately I wasn't successful to understand that either, so I was hoping you could add some more color.
Absolutely. You want to take this one, Dr. Doherty?
Sure. So in the calculation for per pupil, when Gail does the end of the year report, the question that's asked in the end of the year report is how many days do you have without students? In Reading, we have 180 days with students and 5 days without students for teachers. The state took all 5 days, the salaries of the teachers for those 5 days, and applied it to professional development for the per pupil.
And I think
explaining this.
January.
Right,
January.
Sorry.
There was a lot of question about it, so you're not alone.
You're not alone. So it's a, as a finance accounting person, it's a mathematical exercise. If you make $100, I took 180 days of that $100 and put it here, and took 5 days and put it here. So it's not additive, it's not above and beyond. It's literally, I took your salary and bifurcated you between two line items based upon the DESI classification. So we're not, it's not actual additional money out the door for professional development. It's saying, I have a job, they allow me to go to training X number of days. They're going to report to someone to say, we spent X amount on you to go to training, which is
not true.
Not true. It's literally a mathematical, the sum of the two.
Did we point it out to the state or
it's,
Board of Future?
It's the way that the...
I mean, it's nice when teachers see this, they would want to come here for professional development.
We actually are having conversations with our contacts at DESE to try to get further clarification. It's the way that a lot of this works is it's very prescribed by DESE that says classroom A, non-classroom B. So a lot of other, in I wouldn't say it's an integral, I know, and I'm trying not to, one of the questions was, is there any data integrity issues with some of the end of year report. We don't necessarily have insight to every other district. There could be other districts that do half day instead of full day. That doesn't count towards professional
right.
development, because as long as you're in a classroom for half a day, that's teaching and learning, not professional development. So it's really town by town, contract by contract, school year by school year. So it's really difficult to say what other towns are including in that number, because their school year could be designed differently, that they may have 7 half days where they're doing this, it wouldn't show up as professional development. So we actually are going to reach out to DESE and say, this is our actual situation. Is this the how you would anticipate us to be doing it? Because some of the DESE rules have changed over time. So we actually are working with them now to say, it's actually not, we don't feel it's representing, based upon what some of those 5 days are, we feel a different classification, but we're going to reach out to them and get their opinion on it to see if there is a different way that we could be presenting it, because I almost feel it's misleading.
I do too. So it's mostly, to me, misleading when you look at the other districts, because
yes.
you know they're having service days. And so to me, it's their numbers that don't make sense. I can wrap my mind around our numbers, and you also realize that something like 65% maybe of our professional development dollars is based on those extra days, right? It's a significant amount.
It is significant.
So you know those other districts have that, but their numbers don't show it, so it
right.
does seem like there is some disconnect that would be nice to be able to put to bed.
Yes, so we are, especially based upon this, all the conversations we've had, Craig and I are actually reaching out to say, and especially if there is a way we can adjust, we have filed our current end of year report, but it is a dialogue that we're having to say, okay, before these actually become publicized, is there a way for us to address the 16 numbers? Because we understand all of the confusion and the great discussions through the month of January.
If anyone on FinCom or anyone else is interested in a real breakdown of what that number includes, the very first question in the school committee questions includes a breakdown of. Yeah, it was.
I would start from.
DESE,
I was the most popular question.
But, DESE says you're spending all this money, and I think this does a nice job of breaking down how much of it is contractual salary and some other contractual stuff that is not discretionary.
So maybe before I ask my other question, I should read the others. But now that I've started, it's more of a comment, so, which is on technology, which we were just talking about being ranked third. We should feel good about that on equipment and technology.
What page?
Still page 34. Or what is that?
That's a variety of things, not just technology. That's it's all instructional
that's all,
materials.
Okay.
And I think sometimes what's also a little bit difficult is, again, how every school district is structured in how, which is why we say some of the DESI codes where we've seen where we moved people from this category to this category, they might have been categorized as a teacher, but now they're, I'm going to say this wrong again, technology specialist integration.
Yes.
Right.
So we've moved the same person, but we've moved the salaries based upon looking at what the job description is. So some of it is really in the minutiae of exactly what is the person in the position doing. And we have some people that, I might have one person that's divided among four or five different categories depending on what the position is. So again, without being able to look at every school district and what positions they have, it's a little bit difficult to say in totality some of the differences.
Craig, did you have a comment before?
I was just going to give a very concrete example of how there's some variation among various districts with professional development. And you mentioned half days. For instance, if we have a couple of days at elementary and high school where students don't come for conferences, but clearly there's no professional development that's happening on those days. But there are some other districts that I've been in contact with where they might have students attend a half day, and they're doing conferences in the second half of the day, and they might do that for a few days. So it doesn't look like they have those, you know, full days scheduled in there, whereas ours in the past then have been accounted for as professional development. So it's looking like in our discussions with the state and other districts that there are ways to report that more accurately. I mean, we're not just looking to get that number down, we're looking for it really to make sense. And so in our talks with other districts and the state, I think we're moving in that right direction, because I think it is very confusing.
I noticed in one of the earlier slides, the decreases for professional development was 20K for both regular and 20K for special education. However, obviously they're not an equal percentage of the budget. Is there a reason why there's a savings, one isn't twice the other?
For special ed, we basically
cut that out.
And the intent in one of the risks is what will happen with the funding is we basically took it all out, and we are going to solely rely upon grant funding to do the professional development.
It's a special education grant specifically for professional development.
So we're going to basically focus all of the special ed out of either donations that we receive. We're very fortunate. We historically have received a donation from one group each year that's specifically for professional development, and we're really going to be strategizing on the utilization of the grants, and the special ed grants we have more special ed grants that have professional development as part of it, so we basically zeroed out there. So that's why they were the same numbers. We basically said here, they only had 20,000 available, and we said we're going to do it solely out of grant funding. And regular day, we didn't leave a lot left in that one. I think we left 49,000, so we didn't feel we could go any deeper than we did, and we don't have the same flexibility to look towards grant funding for professional development. So that's the long one.
That's helpful. I was just concerned that from a percentage perspective,
a lot of the professional development we do is with all staff integrated, because a lot of the topics focus on good instruction, which really that's what special education is all about too, is how do you provide good instruction for all students. So there is a lot of melding that happens with staff, and that's common.
I have a more general question. On page 14 and the slides there above the paragraph, it says, not included in this budget are funds for unanticipated enrollment increases or extraordinary special education costs, etc. Have we previously set aside or budgeted, included in the budget, these unanticipated? We know we have them. We don't know how much they are.
We do.
How have we handled them previously?
So as part of the budget process, I don't know how many afternoons we spent. So we actually did a bottoms up where we said, okay, who were every student by student known, and then we also trended how many on average over the past 4 to 5 years have we had unanticipated, whether they're 45-day placements or longer term, and we looked and said year over year we know we've always consistently had X or Y number, and we budget a handful of unanticipated because we know every year something will come up, somebody new will move into district. So we do budget every known person, and we can look to see where they are and how, what grade they're in, and how, where they're going to be, what placement they currently have. And then we did do a very detailed backwards review to say, on average, over the past number of years, how many have we had. And we do budget a handful of unanticipated, because if we didn't do that,
so
we know.
There's previously been a cushion.
But it's not, can I just speak, there's not an extraordinary, so we try to, we're pretty conservative in our cushion, so an extraordinary expense is some placements can be upwards of $300,000 for the year. And so that type of unanticipated placement is not something we have budgeted for, and that could be a student that moves into our community that we haven't previously known, and we're then obligated to pay for that. So I think it's just helpful for everyone to know that, yes, we budget for some unanticipated or things that we are in potential litigation for currently that we know things are happening, but we can't always know who might show up. And some of those can be very costly. And so that's the piece, that's always that risk.
So it looks like previous years we've had a cushion, and this year we have no cushion. Am I interpreting that correctly?
I wouldn't say it's a cushion. I think we definitely took a harder look. We did reduce the amount, which actually came up very early in the budget process, where we actually went back to town hall and talked to the town manager and said, the accommodated cost you've actually allocated to us, we've done a bottoms up, we've scrubbed it, we're actually going to give you some of those accommodated costs back. So, because it had assumed a certain percent increase, and we said, looking at what we know today, we basically stripped out some of that and said, what we're doing doesn't support.
Originally, the assumption was a 5% increase in special education for out of districts, and it ended up being a decrease.
So we, again, in looking at every, making sure we were looking at every amount, and we did in December, early December, went back and said we can shift some of the accommodated costs because we just don't have it. So it is sort of a little bit of a risk if somebody did move into district that we had a significant out-of-district placement for. But we felt it was more appropriate to say right now we don't have it, we don't have insight into it.
Should anything then unanticipated happen, that would be a question for Greg.
You'd be seeing us.
Yeah.
Or at least hearing.
And again, we would look to see if there was anything we could do
internally
first before we did it, but some of them can get relatively.
And I wouldn't say that's an FY18 specific issue. That's true of any given given year.
Exactly.
A family could move into September, and we get this downside financial surprise. In any given year, we would come to the finance committee in that. So I don't see that as being FY18 specific. That's an ongoing risk, just part of the nature of special education.
That's all.
I had a couple of questions, if I could. In the current contract, is sick and vacation buyback still part of those? Is it still part of the contract?
Well, in the teacher's contract?
Yes.
There is no such thing as vacation buyback.
Okay.
Because they don't get vacation. They get paid for 185 days.
Beautiful.
Cross that
one off the list.
So that one, yeah.
No vacation. Okay.
In terms of sick leave buyback, there was a sunset clause put in place several years ago. It's anyone that was hired before 1996, I believe. That number is dwindling every year.
Got it. Great. Okay. And that's
so there's
not in the
all of our sick leave buyback have sunset clauses in the contract. All the collective bargaining.
So those should be sunsetting out.
Yep.
Great. Thank you. I asked this of the library. Is there any opportunity to work with Verizon or Comcast on either more equipment or services that they might be willing to offer to the schools?
My quick answer is I believe that's something that would have to come up in the next round of negotiations with the cable.
Okay.
That's where you would probably see something like that.
Great. Okay. It just strikes me that there should be. And maybe that's something we should talk to them about when we next renew.
Mm-hmm. The cable, it'd be the cable, the
right.
one, I believe it's come up in 2 years, yeah.
Great, okay. Next question, on pages 55 and 56 of the questions, we've got the rise analysis. Just so I understand.
Your questions?
No, sorry, of the school committee questions.
Got it.
So like the last couple of pages in the book.
We like to earn our salaries.
Yeah. In fact, double it.
Yeah, exactly.
Also
built into this budget.
Yeah, got it,
yep.
got it. So just to make sure that I understand. So this is kind of the expense budget. So between the tuition and any adjustments made to the revolving fund, those balance. That's the structure. What we bring in revenue should roughly match the expenses, the difference being if there's any adjustment that goes on in the revolving accounts.
So the RISE is in an integrated program for special needs.
What we call typical students.
So there are some students we are obligated to provide services for.
Okay. Got it. So,
so
those would be,
right,
so those won't show.
Whether or not
okay.
we ran an integrated program or not, those little people who turn 3, we provide service to them.
So they'd be a general fund obligation.
Yes.
Okay.
You wouldn't be paying from the revolving fund
right.
for those.
Got
the
it.
The general fund should absorb what the requirement is regarding IEP students. Mm-hmm.
So what
right.
we take in from the revolving fund is to support
the integrated,
the integrated
okay. Okay.
aspect
so that's
of
that
the program.
Yes.
Tuition.
Okay, because this gave a good picture of the cost. I just wanted to make sure I understood the revenue side.
And there is the revolving fund support offset is reflected in the table.
Got it, $380,000.
Yes.
Got it. Okay, thank you.
And then
right.
as part
right.
of that, we did show, we do have some grants that are very specific to
early
childhood.
Right.
So we wanted to be all inclusive and say if you were looking at in there is some grant funding that is very specific to this, so that was why we included sort of an all-inclusive look, because we did want to say we do get some state federal aid as
great.
Well.
Okay, thank you. On the FinCom list now, question 18.
Yep.
Yeah, another set.
You don't have extra copy of that, do you?
I'm
no.
sorry,
I
don't
okay.
have an extra copy.
I'll
read the question.
I'll look on the skip. Thank you.
So this is about tuition on special ed programs. As outlined in Figure 60, we received $195,639 in special education tuition in our revolving fund. The figures remained relatively consistent over the last several years, is trending to be in line for the current fiscal year. My question was, how is the tuition, special ed tuition determined? Does it cover our costs? How does it compare to other facilities, locations? Whatever, just making sure, are we capturing?
Well, yeah, I'll let Caroline answer this.
So when I started, the tuition was set. I worked closely with Martha to kind of evaluate the staffing in those programs. We looked at increases. We wanted to make sure that we were comparable to collaboratives or special ed, private special ed schools. We don't want to overprice
right.
ourselves. We like districts to pay to come to Reading. So we kind of looked at it in that sense. The other piece is if a student needs something that is above and beyond our program staff. So for instance, we have students who require a one-to-one paraprofessional. We bill the sending district specifically for that salary of that paraprofessional plus the tuition. And if that student were to return or leave our district, then that paraprofessional job goes away. We would continue to run our program
right.
that we have. So we look at the expenses in that program. So each program has different expenses, whether it's a special ed teacher, general education teachers, the support of speech and language, occupational therapy, physical therapy, a BCBA. So we have lots of specialty programs and kind of gauge that. And we've always increased those about 2.5-3% annually. And most of the districts have been very happy. We continue to get referrals into our programs, which is nice. And we do have students leaving our programs because districts would like students to return. So we also honor that as well and help those students transition back. So we do take a look at, we don't want to outprice ourselves either.
Right, right.
so it's being reviewed regularly?
Yes, yep, and we're tracking that and.
Beautiful. Next question, steps. Can you just tell us how those are established, what they represent? Are they based on time? Are they based on degrees? Are they based on training? Are they based on all of the above?
I'm assuming you're talking about teachers.
Teachers, I'm sorry, I'm jumping.
So you have two pieces in a salary schedule. One is called columns. And depending on the collective bargaining agreement, columns represent usually degrees or degrees plus credits. So we have a bachelor's column. We have, a bachelor's plus 15, a bachelor's plus 30, a master's column, a master's plus 30 column. We have a double master's column and a doctorate column. I believe those are the columns we have. So those are the columns. And depending on the degree that you have and the number of credits, you're appropriately placed on one of those columns. You can move from column to column if you get advanced degrees, which some people do. The majority of our teachers are masters, because you are required within 5 years to get a master's degree to teach in, to have license from Massachusetts. You then have steps, and there are 13 steps in the collective bargaining agreement for teachers. Those steps represent years of service. So if I'm a brand new teacher, never have taught before, and I come into the Reading Public Schools, I would be on step one. If I am coming in from the Reading Public Schools and I've taught for 4 years somewhere else, I would be put on step five, because that's the next step coming in.
Just in Massachusetts or teaching anywhere?
That's pretty standard for public schools.
Okay, anywhere.
Except 13 would usually be 13 years or not necessarily.
If you started step one and went through the whole school district in one place, that would be 13 years, yes. Once you reach top step, all you get each year is the cost of living adjustment. And I believe about 40% of our teachers, about 40% of our teachers are at top step, 60% are on steps at some place. And it's pretty evenly spread out among the 12 steps, and then you'd have the big spike at the 13th step.
So if you're not maxed out in steps, you get a step every year?
Yes.
Okay. That's what I meant to tell you.
Yes. That is also pretty standard in collective bargaining agreements in schools.
And you said 40% are maxed out.
40% are on top step approximately right now, yeah.
One more question. Substitutes. So I noted a couple of questions about it, and there was a comment that unfilled, I guess, situations are about 16 to 20% of the circumstance. Is there, in cases where it is a filled absence, how often do we have lesson plans in place? I'm wondering if there's some way to kind of centralize students in the case of a substitute, if it's unplanned. Planned, I get. Unplanned, I'm
wondering. I don't think it's something you would want to do with the lower grades. it would not be an advisable practice. Middle and high school, it's also tricky. I mean, you want to do that more as a last resort when you don't have other staffing available. The way we fill substitute, if we don't have a substitute available, we do use paraeducators. They do get a differential for covering classes up after a certain period of time. You can have teachers that may have additional planning time to cover classes if that's available. Sometimes administrators have to cover classes. You really want to use bringing them all together as a last resort, because there isn't a lot of true teaching going on if you're putting them all in, you know, one room from all different classes.
Yeah, no, it's the question, I guess, was in a situation where you're not going to have the opportunity for teaching anyway, is there a way to organize it? The answer probably is that's what you end up having to do.
You can. It would be as a last resort.
Yep. Okay, I relinquish the floor. Other questions? Go ahead, Vanessa.
There's a great chart on page 35 of the
Which questions?
Is it the FinCom question?
Oh, question number?
No, it's not, so it's the, okay.
69.
69, yep.
It talks about the reading percentage and numbers of teachers reading the district over the last several years. There's a concerning trend of teachers leaving to go to jobs in different districts. Last year, there were 3 departures because job demands were too heavy.
So we have done an analysis of our salary schedules with the comparable communities that I know town and schools use. And in the early steps of the salary schedule, we're fairly competitive. After about the 3rd or 4th step is when we start losing ground. And we slowly... Well, not slowly. We pretty much go below average with the comparable communities as you get more and more towards step 13. So we are below average as you go towards the end of the scale. And we're fairly competitive at the beginning of the scale. So what we're seeing a trend that's starting to happen is you have teachers that come into the Reading Public Schools. We're giving them all kinds of training. We're giving them support with a mentor and... then after 4 or 5 years, when they've really started learning the ins and outs of being an effective teacher, there are situations which they look at other school districts and with more competitive salaries. And, so that's the challenge that we seem to be facing, particularly in the high profile positions where that are more difficult. To find, which are special education, math and sciences, foreign language, things like that.
Thank you. Questions from the committee? Eric, you look ready.
Well, this was addressed in the FinCom questions. I just wanted to build on one. The proportions in district, out of district shifted, I think, from 60-40 to 68-32. Is there a strategic target of where you want to be with that proportion, or is it just...
I can start the answer and I'll let Carolyn finish it. Our goal, there are some students that we're not able to educate in district just because of their unique disabilities. But certainly our goal is to have as many students that are on IEPs in district as possible, because from a community standpoint, a peer standpoint, it's in their best interest and best interest of all the students. Unfortunately, sometimes that requires more space than we have, and space is a determining factor.
That was my follow-up.
We've been able to navigate that, but space is, and you do have to provide adequate space for special education programs. They need to have similar and equal space as a general education student. There is no set number. Our goal is to, as much as possible, educate as many of our students as possible in district.
I think the other piece, and I've presented this to the school committee, is just that process and making that determination. It isn't us as the administrative team saying this is our target.
Yep.
Each of those decisions is made by an individualized team of people who know that child the best. So at different points in the school year, a child may need something different because of their disability. So there's great fluctuation in out-of-district and in-district. We have students who move back in-district in January. We have students who go out-of-district in January. So there's a lot of fluctuation in that number, and it's hard to kind of say,
right,
you know, here's where it's going to be at, or this is our target. Our goal is that we are following the federal and state requirements as well, and ensuring that we're having these decisions made through a team process, and that we're providing the best programs that we can for our students in district. And as Dr. Doherty mentioned, the space is an issue. So for some of our programs, our enrollment might be lower, but we need a bigger space because those students require specialized equipment. Some of our students require specialized seating. They need spaces to have calming spaces in the classroom environment. Some of our students need access to life skills work. So we need, at Coolidge Middle School, we have a classroom that has an oven in it and a sink. So there's a lot of facets that go with that, and we've done a lot of walkthroughs in our buildings to try to identify really appropriate space to meet students' educational needs. So we do have some limitations, and I think that has impacted our ability to grow some of our programs because we do have limitations in what we can offer in our buildings.
So space is becoming, or is,
mm-hmm,
is already,
yeah,
a cap on, it could be higher if not,
mm-hmm,
for a space issue.
I know you're not able to speak to a number that you feel confident in terms of being able to kind of recoup throughout the year to offset that 580 number. But how confident do you feel that the town manager's proposal moving forward will be one that works? Because I think we got a sense from the town side that they feel pretty comfortable with it. I don't know how comfortable or confident the schools feel with it.
I put up there a lot of risks.
Yeah.
And so I don't want to ever say that we have 100% confidence,
absolutely,
in addressing those risks, because every year,
sure,
we have something happen that,
right,
that,
right,
it's going to impact the budget.
Mm-hmm.
We will certainly do everything we can,
mm-hmm,
to work with the town,
mm-hmm,
to get to the number that we need to get to.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's, I guess that's the promise we can make.
Mm-hmm.
This is, you know, as I think I was alluding to, this is my eighth budget,
mm-hmm,
as a superintendent managing,
mm-hmm,
in my eighth budget. And you know, we do everything we can to make sure that the dollar is spent as efficiently as possible in providing meeting the educational needs of the students. And I think the track record shows that. So we'll do everything we can to accomplish that goal. That's the best we can promise. I mean, some things look promising right now in some areas,
mm-hmm,
but we haven't even started the school year yet. You know, and the budget, as I said earlier, was developed in November. A lot can happen.
Sharon, I was just wondering, does the new snow snowfall impact your level of confidence at all? I know it's a different budget year, so it doesn't impact it at all. Okay. Okay. Thanks.
Neither rain nor snow.
This isn't something that's uncommon from other years.
Right.
You know.
Right. Right. Okay.
We tend to move any excess we have that we close to free cash to clear that,
mm-hmm,
snow.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Vanessa.
I have a delicate issue that I've written very tentatively because it hasn't really been discussed, and that's athletics. And it was one of the questions on page,
mm-hmm,
44. I don't, it's question 79. I don't know which of the many list of questions is there, but.
We will put it all into one document at some point.
No, the Q&A second half has been really helpful, so I appreciate that. You know, but when we talk about increasing middle school classes to 30 and then now being concerned about math and reading, and we're talking about potentially losing foreign language also in middle schools, and while I know that there's been some offsets and some increases in fees, I wonder the thought process that went into leaving that particular portion of the budget essentially untouched. I recognize the importance of it, having done sports myself throughout high school. But I'm concerned at the sacrifices that we're making on the academic side. So could you tell me a little bit about the thought process that went into that portion of it?
And wasn't there, there was actually like a 26 or 25% increase, right, in athletics?
Yes.
You had expense increases.
Expense.
Primarily transportation. Yeah. But the 25% is kind of deceiving because you're also decreasing the offset.
It's very deceiving. It is such a 26% increase in expenses.
Mm-hmm.
It is because of the offset change.
Yeah,
okay.
That it was a combination.
Okay.
I think I said this one night at one of the meetings. First of all, primarily the coaches' salaries are paid for by the user fee.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So if you remove the user fee, you're going to have to make additional cuts in athletics. So we've always considered a user fee a cut because it is already being subsidized in addition to what would be normally in the operating budget. On top of that, though, there are some students, and I include extracurricular, not just athletics, because I think they're one and the same. They're opportunities for students to show skills that they necessarily were not able to show in a classroom setting. There's a lot of students that come to school each day for that reason. And if we are now starting to reduce those opportunities for students, I think you're going to see a higher rate of absenteeism. I think you're going to see a higher rate of students that are going to struggle academically. I think you're going to see a higher rate of students that exhibit more types of issues. I also think you're going to see more kids leave the school district. Because I do think these are programs that keep kids in our schools and keep kids in our classrooms and motivated to learn. I think they play a very important part, drama, music, art, and the athletics, all these extracurricula, play a very important role. You start cutting those, we looked at several different options to reduce the athletic budget. We looked at cutting all freshman sports. We looked at reducing the number of games that each team played. It was not a significant impact on the total athletic budget. You would have to eliminate total sports. And, you see what kids can do in those settings, and sometimes that's the things that keep them going during the day. I don't know if that.
Chuck had a comment on that also.
I think, and I think you said it, I don't think athletics were overlooked because by virtue of raising the fee, we considered that in balancing the budget. And by the way, we just raised it 2 years ago. 2 years ago?
Yeah.
So, where RISE was raised the first time in 5 years, I think, right? So, and where we have surrounding communities that don't even charge fee. Woburn doesn't charge an athletic fee.
I saw the chart. It was
Burlington, Burlington does it.
So, and as Dr. Daugherty said, so much value is gotten out of that for some kids. I couldn't even imagine. I don't even like raising fees two years later because it's tough on some people. But we're doing that. So.
Mind you, I'm not advocating.
No, I know that.
We did take a serious look.
Yeah. It's one of the few sort of isolated siloed portions of the budget that's stands out. So
I have two responses, kind of summing up what's already been said for myself. One is more quantitative, that the savings just aren't there. Everything I looked at in this budget was how do I get to 438K? That was my objective, not even close. So first of all, it won't work to solve our problem. The nibbling around the edge is what if we cut a few games, what if we cut a couple sports? The other challenge that I think is really problematic is once you start looking at cutting athletics in addition to Title IX and gender equality issues, is the how do you decide which group of kids you're gonna say, not next year. You know how you're gonna say that you're gonna be a captain on your college application? Nope. I mean, this huge, Dr. Doherty mentioned motivation for a certain group of students, and I certainly agree with him. For some students, it's why they come for school. For other students, it's where they get their leadership. It's where they, it could be scholarship money for some kids. So to suddenly deprive them of that opportunity, I think is terribly cruel. So that was just something else that, but it, we absolutely looked at it. I think it's a good question to ask.
Paul.
Okay. It might be probably a tough question to answer, but as you look at user fees, do you have a sense of kind of what we might be pricing out? Is there a population of, that's what I worry, there's got to be some population of kids who can't play that sport because there's any user fee whatsoever, and that, you know, that alone makes me nervous. And Dr. Doherty, to your point, that I think there's a significant population, at least there was when I was a kid, there certainly was to me personally growing up, that yes, your motivation to go to school every day to do well, yeah, it changed as I became an adult, but as a kid it was to make sure I could play in the games, and that was, I'll be perfectly honest, well, yeah, hopefully, you know, but so to hear, yeah, we're looking at potentially, you know, cutting freshman sports, I'm glad we're looking everywhere, that scares me incredibly. And so on several other cuts on there, I'm not saying, but the thought of cutting back in areas, because I think there's, you know, and I say athletics, but it's just as important as art and drama, the after school stuff. I think you keep a lot of kids out of trouble and focused in school for that reason.
And I'll add to that, I many people know I'm a former high school teacher, and good teachers figure that out very early. And where there is a motivational issue, I absolutely have conversations with high school students where I said, you know, I don't start seeing the homework coming, I'm going to have to talk to your coach. Done. Over. Completely solve the problem. So you're right. It would create significant problems.
Paul, to your point, you know, we do have a sliding, we do have a scale for students that are free reduced lunch.
Yep.
The school committee also this year kept the family cap the same. So the family cap did not increase with the tuition increase.
Okay.
So those two things, and I know that's not going to impact everyone that's struggling, but it does have some safety net.
With an attempt.
Yeah. Okay.
Erica.
Yeah, just building on the athletics piece, it was a concern I had too.
Yeah.
I emailed Ms. Borowski on it. She was kind enough to give me a long, thought-out answer. And I hesitate to go too far here because our role is not necessarily to make decisions on how you spend your money, right? It's more to look at the financial impact and efficiency and all that. My initial concern with the athletics piece was, and this was before the coaching path forward and all that, if you cut all athletics, you could have paid for the 7 middle school teachers, right? And so my initial kind of simplistic black and white thinking was there's a conscious decision being made to value athletics higher than academics. And that was the question I posed.
Mm.
If you just look at black and white, right? I think what I'm hearing you say, and what I'd like to do is ask it explicitly, is it the opinion of, and then I'll trust your judgment on this, is it the opinion of the administration and the school committee that cutting athletics across the board would have a greater academic impact than the cuts initially proposed or currently proposed?
So we have a quorum, so
yeah.
I won't speak for every member.
Yeah.
For me, absolutely.
Okay.
But if everyone else from the school.
A greater academic impact.
Yeah. I'm getting a nod from Mr.
I believe the social emotional behavioral consequences of cutting the athletics would interfere greatly with the academics.
really significant unknown. It's such a huge unknown that in my mind it's tantamount to the analogy I used in some of our discussions. It's like taking a car, pulling a spark plug out of it, and putting your kid in the back seat and seeing if it'll still go. And I'm not willing to take that risk with our students.
Brandon, do you have questions? I saw you came with a little list there.
No.
Kevin?
Yep.
Okay. Anything else from the committee? No. Public questions? So let me try to kind of wrap a little bit around where we are, I think, now. This far right-hand side here, the proposal, is very important for us. So it sounds like there will be a, I don't want to call it a new budget, there'll be a different budget number that you'll be putting forward that will be the balanced budget number that will go to the town manager. Is that, am I reading that correctly?
Well, that's under the town manager's proposal. I think what you heard tonight, certainly the administration or other school committee members, to tell me if you're wrong, I don't see how we can do that in good faith. What that says to me is just add $438 back to the budget and say it's going to be okay. From what I'm hearing from the administration, do we need the full $438? Absolutely not. We are going to find efficiencies. There will be unanticipated financial upside, certainly, as there is every year we return to free cash. But historically, it's never been close to $400,000. So I don't see how we could honestly balance the budget and add seven FTEs. The money isn't there. It would strike me as a dishonest thing to do.
So let me bring it very much full circle. I'll give my opinion. This town desperately needs to do an override that's going to be able to provide the services that are required for town and schools. The form of that last time didn't happen. It needs to come back. It needs to come back quickly. Otherwise, we're going to be cutting athletics or foreign language or other things. So there is a proposal to figure out a way to keep foreign language. The town manager made a specific proposal. I think what I'm hearing is that the school committee made a different proposal, which is they have a budget that they put in front of us that has, assuming the $150,000 would come out of fiscal 17, then the request for 18 would be 438.
Yeah, I think the 150, that's what we did last year.
Yeah.
I think that's a fine path
yeah.
plan. So I think we can take the 150 off the table.
Okay, so we'll, as a warrant article, we'll be voting on that separately next week. Go ahead, Ms.
The science curriculum was a three-year implementation, correct? 150, 150, and 150.
Yeah.
150 was in
this current
this,
school year.
This
was, and that was already
that was voted on
at the end of
last year.
So we actually used FY16 money and bought everything before June.
And so now there's an ask now for April time, meaning for another 150. So we still have 150. The third piece.
We
right?
did not build that into this year's budget because of all of the other fiscal challenges we have.
I see. Okay. So it's being delayed a year.
No. No.
Right.
Instead of making
like
it as part of the FY18 budget, the town manager has identified money at the end of FY17, and we can pre-purchase all the material before June 30th for next year.
I think she's referring to
the third year.
Third year, well, we don't know yet. That would be.
That's the one that's being.
That would be
indefinitely.
I presume we'll ask
that,
for free cash
that would,
in FY19.
Yeah, that's an FY19 issue.
So
one budget part from here.
Yeah, yeah. Right, you're going to, so if I get it right,
but then everyone will have science, so
yeah.
Then we won't ask again.
So it was proposed initially as 150 per year for 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
The discussion in FY16 at the end was to put it into that budget so it would be available for the start of the 17 school year.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
That we supported and it went through town meeting and was approved, so that took place. This would be the second of the three, again being sought the same way. The third is not on our horizon at the moment.
Okay.
Is that a pretty good summary?
Mm-hmm. Perfect.
Chuck, do you have a comment?
Yeah, I think, as we've talked tonight, as Bob, the town managers, put out, willing to find other, we're willing, I think what Dr. Daugherty has said and others that will be willing to look at that, but we do need more level of free cash than the $1.2 million use. Maybe not the 438, but something more than the $1.2 million. I guess that's what we're asking for, with the understanding that, you know, we'll look for it in other, but we can't commit to where that's coming from tonight.
Right.
Does that make sense with how we talked?
Yeah, so just to be clear, the right now in the budget is $1.1 million of free cash.
And you had originally said 1.2.
We had suggested,
right,
that up to 1.2.
I'm sorry, I know I misspoke. You said, I said the $1.2 million because,
right,
you had said that earlier. You're right.
Right.
Yeah, I think we
so
reduced
one
it because we got the health care numbers, and that's why.
Right.
Well, that was also
it was actually
the
something
the
other different
cost, right?
Right.
Yeah. $200
yeah.
back in the school budget.
Right.
So what I was saying is, so I guess if we went up to that $1.2 million, we're asking for you to go up a little more than that, and we'll, you know, collaborate with the town to offset as much of that as we can. But we this moving parts just can't commit to it.
Another complication. Right? Yeah, completely agree with everything you just said. Another complication. It's a sensitive issue, so I want to be thoughtful about how I present this. But we're talking real employees, real people. And so whatever plan we have needs to assure them that their salaries are funded for the next year. So any approach that is what we think, and maybe, and if things go well, and perhaps, we'll be okay. And if not, halfway through the year, we're going to go to town meeting and ask for more free cash. I don't think that is... I don't think that gives our employees the level of certainty about their job security that they deserve, especially in the environment that we find ourselves in.
So I think what's before us is two budgets, if you will. One as proposed here by the school committee, less than 150, so that's in fiscal 17. And a second budget, which will be, by definition, somehow balanced, but including the seven FTEs. The question upon to us is going to be,
mechanically, how do we make
how do we work that through? So the school committee has made clear their desire. The town manager has made clear that he wants to support it and is willing to offer up at this point $132,000 conceivably. As I mentioned before, we have 1.1 in the budget out of 1.2 that we had suggested. So we should discuss that. And then that would, even if all those things happen, that still leaves some kind of a gap that we'll need to discuss. We are charged with bringing something forward to town meeting that we have to vote next week because it goes to press right after that. So we need to think about how we can do this. And I think maybe now is a good time to start a discussion of different ideas, though tonight we do not vote it. We vote it next week.
Mark, can I give one clarification that I think is important? Bob, as part of his proposal, did say that he could do some savings on the town side. That would be during the next fiscal year. That would not be part of a balanced budget for the schools.
He would be given that in November.
Right. So
right.
I think it's important that the balanced budget piece has to be a school department balanced budget, not including the town, whatever the town can.
About $150,000 of expenses that we will not spend until we know what the status of the school side is.
Mm-hmm.
And then he will request a transfer from the town side to the school at a November town meeting.
Right.
But to fully understand
sure we that last
Bob's
point.
Plan, I think you really do need an executive session to understand, because I honestly don't think that you're grasping all.
So
I just feel like what I know that I can't say is probably getting you not to understand where that piece comes from, in his mind, anyway.
Okay.
I'm just hesitant to have too much of this discussion now tonight. I think
yeah.
it's sort of the mechanics that we work through. I don't think it's necessarily.
Okay. So I think we've heard the request specifically. There will be some kind of a number that balances to the overall budget separately.
teachers, keeping the foreign language in seventh grade. And I think we're, that's the common ground, and it's mechanically how to make that happen.
How do you get it closed?
Just say one thing.
One quick question, just, are other people comfortable with that approach of, it's kind of, we have the information in front of us, we've asked our questions, we kind of hang on, which I guess would probably either require or preclude an executive session to take place. Because next week we do need to vote on this. Sorry, think about that, go ahead, Jean, I'm sorry.
You touched on this, Mark, but I just really do think we need to make it abundantly clear. This is a one-time ask, and it assumes a second override attempt. That without mm-hmm. another override vote, this honestly doesn't make sense. Our absolute assumption is that the Board of Selectmen will call for another override vote in the next year. And we are fully aware that this is a one-time. We are fully aware that this is a band-aid. This is not sustainable. We're the first to admit it. But in the event that the community does vote to approve an override in the next year, to your point, Paul, and I thank you for saying it, I think we can all agree that decimating a language program for one school year and then trying to rebuild it would be foolish. So I did want to make that point that this is a one-year temporary fix.
The other thing with this, throwing a number, 38,000, 438,000, whatever number you want to put in there, if we don't fund that and we have to go back to April town meeting to get more money, and town meeting doesn't give it to you,
yep.
I mean, that's serious problems. I mean, that's not seven teachers anymore. That's because you've only got a couple months to spread it out. So, you know, it's.
I'm sorry, you mean November?
No, it went so far.
Oh, all the way. Oh,
if you're still looking for the difference.
Yeah.
I think that's a really valid point, and
it's
a concern I have.
2 months.
Right.
Which
yep.
is, you can't do that possibly. So.
The only reason I'm not as concerned about that is we're going in eyes wide open. Anything we do is going to be eyes wide open with town meeting. So we'd be getting town meeting support, perhaps, to take that risk with the expectation if that risk didn't get off. So now the dynamics of the town meeting have changed dramatically in 12 months, but that would be a little bit.
I feel conflicted about whether we should have an executive session. On the one hand, you know, I think in order for us to be able to advise town meeting adequately, we need to have as much information as possible. But in order to present information to town meeting that they can digest, we need to be able to be open and transparent with what we can tell them. And so I'm struggling with that, and I don't know where the balance lies there.
So how to phrase this? I'm not sure I agree with Sharon's comment. I don't know that there's enough certainty that comes from the results of the executive session to change things dramatically in terms of what we'd be bringing to town meeting, what town meeting would know, even how we feel about it. I guess that's the right way to say it. I'm just not sure that, you know, I think that there may be a little more understanding, but there's no more certainty.
Mm-hmm.
That's my judgment.
Two comments after listening for a couple of hours here. I am a town meeting member, and there is quite a bit of concern already that the school committee has not submitted to the town manager and the FinCom a balanced budget according to charter. And the majority of people in the town did not support an override for various reasons. And this does not help the cause to suggest executive sessions or to go against what is your mandate by regulation to cooperate with all sides of town government. It's very disturbing to a lot of people. It's disturbing to myself and people who know I'm involved, and people are looking for answers. So you're going to have to explain that and not just talk amongst yourselves. It's got to be something that's real. Number one. And number two, the, now I have to think a minute. The other part of it was, about coming up with the, I'm sorry, I just I'm so concentrated on the one issue. Coming up with the free cash, it needs to be with guidelines that are already directed, but you need to consider the Department of Revenue's guidelines that it's not for salaries, because they believe it's bad fiscal practice to do that. And it's not supposed to be for reoccurring expenses as well. And now it sounds like, you know, I know the town manager's trying to accommodate a need, but it's not supposed to be for reoccurring events either. And the example they give is if a police car is so badly damaged that you have to spend money that you didn't budget for to get it repaired, to get it back on the road, that's an expense for free cash. But to put salaries in there, knowing it's a one-time thing, is not good financial practice. So I'd just like you to consider that in your use of it, because that will come up again, because we don't want to get into the habit of rewarding bad behavior for not cooperating with the regulations and the parameters that have already been decided for how the town spends money, and then say, well, we really like you, so we're going to try to enable you to get what you want. That's not what the voters voted on. They need a good faith effort by the school department to work within the constraints that they have, and then they may get a buy-in the next time around. But this is a test for them, and how they handle that test, how transparent you are, how public you are, and how articulate you can speak frankly and honestly with the public will go a long way in helping your cause. And FinCom is not here to enable everyone to do what they want. FinCom is here for the best purposes of the town as a whole, and not to encourage divisiveness and not to take sides. But we all need to work for the bottom line to get the best that we can for all the people that we represent in town. Thank you.
Appreciate the comment. I think that we have this year in particular demonstrated very responsible fiscal practices in the face of where we are as a community in our financial situation and what the result of the override was. You know, we made clear what our intention was and what we wanted to do and why. I think that what we are working with is the notion of a one-year potential opportunity here. This is not a sustainable practice. Anybody in this room believes that it is. So, you know, that's we're not going to, you know, find a way to do this, you know, going forward. It won't. It's not possible. And I don't think people on the committee would vote for it. I would not either. By the same token, I think we have to look at how we do our budgeting, how we regenerate cash, and make some decisions on what risk we're all going to be willing to take and recommend to town meeting. At the end of the day, in a very open and transparent fashion, need to explain what we're thinking and why. At town meeting, we'll get to vote on it. And that's the process that we'll use.
So I know we're going back and forth about executive session, or do we talk about it now, but I guess, are you looking for feedback right now on our thoughts around the 438, and or are we holding that for another discussion
before I go further? Yeah, so before you go for the policy suggestion, was we wait.
Okay.
We make that next week's
activity. I think
that's
critical.
I think what that will also do is we need to make a formal decision about executive session or not. And I think we should have a quick discussion about that and decide if that's something we think makes sense. Again, I gave you my opinion. I don't think it adds any certainty. And the fact that it couldn't be brought up to town meeting makes it almost irrelevant in my view.
I'm concerned about having an executive session from the perspective of this is following a failed override and the litigation.
Mm-hmm.
And in town meeting shoes and in the residents' shoes, I'd be very frustrated to know that once again private conversations are happening that affect the town and that they are not privy to, and that decisions are being made blindly as far as they're concerned. It's an issue of trust, and I think we've struggled with that recently. So, and I agree with you that I don't know how much it'll change, the certainty factor. So it seems, you know, when we talk about these risks, we're also risking frustrating town meeting and town residents by keeping this information.
It's probably easier, my guess is, for us as the finance committee to trust the town leaders who've told us what their expectations are than it would be for town meeting to trust us, in a sense. Like, if you're telling us this is what you're working with and what your expectations are, and we've, you know, all worked together before, that's, in some ways, it's easier, I think, than for town meeting to just take on faith whatever we say came out of executive session that we can't tell them.
Just a bit of devil's advocate. If one of our primary roles, or our primary role, is to advise town meeting on all matters financial, does foregoing an executive session, could be a rhetorical question, I guess, but diminish that capability? Whereas if we had the executive session, we'd be in a better position to advise town meeting. If that's true, to me, it's an argument for executive session. Now, from the comments that have been made, I don't know if it necessarily improves our ability to advise town meeting. If that, only in that instance, I think, am I comfortable with it. The devil's advocate piece is building on what you said, Anne. I guess, town meeting would potentially be trusting us, if we did go into an executive session, be trusting us and town leadership.
Mm-hmm.
And in theory, they look to us for advice on all matters financial, so it would put us in a better position to do that. But as you can tell from my comments, I'm a little bit back and forth, but these are the thoughts going through my head.
It's not easy.
It also does not need to be a unanimous vote.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
So if people have a certain feeling on an issue, that's where you can say it. If you don't feel, you know, let's say we don't do an executive session, you don't feel like you have enough information to make a decision, then you don't. So I think there's that option too. I felt like the way we're talking about it, we're almost like we all have to agree.
Mm.
We don't.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I think it's healthy that we don't sometimes. So with that said, I think my personal opinion is executive session is going to do far more damage than it will help the town.
I have to agree with Eric. I mean, I would go back and forth myself with everything that's been said, so just leave it at that.
I think it comes down to how we use free cash, and if we do use free cash, well, presumably if we don't use free cash, we will regenerate less next year if we have to come up with the extra money in a subsequent town meeting. I feel all the executive session, I would tend to agree, it's not really going to add that much unless somebody can tell us, we know this is going to happen. I think what we've got to make decisions based on what we know now, not on what we think might happen.
Mm-hmm.
So.
I'm confident we can come up with a way we can approach this without executive session. The optics are
should probably vote.
Okay, so we have a motion, please. Then I guess we'll get to the effect of to authorize the
move that.
So I guess the motion to authorize, how you make the motion to authorize an executive session.
Oh, so we vote against it, okay.
Right. Alright, so all those in favor of authorizing executive session, please raise your hand.
I just want to follow up and make sure I understood the comment made from the public about timing of the school committee coming back and not having a balanced budget yet, and just kind of offering up, you know, my thought and opinion on that. I think this has been an extremely collaborative process, as it has been for the past several years. You know, at the right time, I think town meeting will see that. We'll see all the work that went into it. At the end of the day, whether or not the 438 gets approved or how, we will get to an answer. I'm extremely comfortable and confident that we will get to an answer. The budget will be correct. I commend you guys, honestly, for coming back with the additional request for 438. You've been put in a tough position, so haven't all the other departments. But you've gone through it honestly and said, no, this is what it takes. You're fighting for something you believe strongly in. I appreciate that. That's not a fun spot to be in. You're well aware of the optics of what happened with an override. You're working from a difficult position, but you're saying, this is what it's going to take. This is what we think is in the best interest, and we'll work there. If we get it, we get it. If you don't, we will have to regroup. But, and I may be missing some of the point, but to me, I don't care when we get to the answer, within reason, right? But let's get to the right answer. And so I'm sure it wasn't taken lightly, and it wasn't an easy thing to get to this point in the process and still be saying, we need that extra 438, even though you told us no at the beginning. So, you know, we'll continue the good conversation and we'll get to an answer. But it's a tough position to be in, and I'm glad you guys are putting up for, you know, standing up for what you think is the right answer.
And to the extent Paul went to high school looking forward to sports after school, you know, I fell in love with the Spanish language in seventh grade, was a Spanish major, studied abroad in Spain, did a Fulbright year in Spain. So, and all that's what, you know, started in seventh grade with Spanish.
Yes.
Touche.
I think I would add one more thing too, which is that the, you know, as it is a school department request, the town side of the government, the municipal side of the government, agrees with the request and is willing to move things around to accommodate it taking place also. So it's a request that, you know, cooperatively government is bringing forward. And then the question before us is figuring out what can be done in a fiscally responsible fashion.
Three quick points. I wanted to thank Mr. McNeese for those kind comments and that support. I don't know if you forwarded my email to you after our last meeting to the rest of the FinCom. And if you didn't, I should publicly.
I may not have.
Yes. After our last meeting, I was so impressed with your response to the unbalanced budget that we passed. It was a very hard vote. We struggled mightily with it. And your response to it was serious. The discussion was so thoughtful. I was very impressed by the collaborative spirit of partnership. I actually did email your chair and thanked him for your committee and for your willingness to, I should have sent it to the whole committee.
Sorry, my bad.
But I don't normally do stuff like that, but I went home and just went, boy, I'm very grateful this is our finance committee and that we can come to you and have these conversations. I also do want to say that it's now beginning to sound like we're solving a huge big problem. Even with the 438, we're looking at 10.9 FTE cuts. We shouldn't lose sight of that. This is not a solution. It's a grasping. So I don't want to suggest that the school committee is unwilling to take, you know, to make hard choices, cutting 11 FTEs and over $100,000 in expenses in our fifth year of doing so. So I certainly hope that presents to the community a good faith effort to work within our means. And my final point was about these particular cuts. And I know I'm probably everyone in this room knows, the school committee is actually not just speaking for ourselves. We're speaking on behalf of the over 200 parents, 200 plus, that came out to public hearings and school committee meetings and said, please do not cut the middle school language program. So we're not just speaking for the six of us. We're speaking on behalf of the parents who overwhelmingly spoke to us and said, please don't do this. So,
and students, by the way.
Oh, my goodness. And a petition, hundreds and hundreds of signatures by high school students who signed a petition. And I don't know if any of you saw, but the middle school students who spoke, just I wasn't half that articulate when I was in middle school. I mean, so impressive, and so thoughtful and professional and respectful and so impressive. So I do feel like the school committee is speaking on behalf of that whole group. So thank you.
Is there additional information that you need for next week from us?
So I think we are in fact going to need the version of the balanced budget, just so that that exists. And then I think it is within FinCom's purview specifically to make adjustments.
What balanced budget are
so
you referring
close to?
To
balance budget.
I think that goes back to the
yeah.
original superintendent's budget.
Yeah, that's
it's just a dollar.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
It removes
yes.
the middle school positions.
Yes.
Well, it's just a dollar figure.
Is it?
Right.
Yes.
Because
right,
we only
yeah,
have
so
bottom line.
Right.
I mean,
we only have bottom line.
You just have to balance it. It's not something we necessarily have to provide. You can just
I guess,
balance it.
Isn't that just
because we're
a
single
right?
line item, right? So
we are a single line item.
So it's
right.
The number is
right.
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 So the number is the.
I think so.
That's the way I
yeah,
understood
you,
it.
Make
yes.
sure you, yes. you vote on the bottom line.
Yeah, so the
and town meeting
4180,
well.
Yeah. 9661, less 438, and less 150. Is that number that would, quote unquote, balance? And then again, it's within our purview to recommend to town meeting the budget that we feel is appropriate.
All right, now I'm confused. I'm sorry. So what additional information will you need?
So I think as it's a bottom line number, I don't think we need additional information.
Okay.
But I will make this offer. Myself, Mr. Robinson, Dr. Doherty, and Ms. Dowd will certainly be available if over the next week you come up with questions that need
yes.
addressing.
Oh, absolutely.
By all means, reach out. We want to get you whatever you need.
I do wonder if there, to the extent you have identified money that, you know, between the difference between retirement and new hires, like if there's like a minimum number that you expect,
it's gonna be.
You know, any that could be useful. And if you can't, but if
no,
you just said,
you know,
yep.
At a minimum, we expect this.
More on the line of almost a goal as opposed to a
yes.
promise.
Yeah.
Similar to
yep.
not even a goal, but
not
like
even a goal.
At a minimum, we
the
today
minimum.
This is what it looks
yeah.
like.
Something
yeah.
we can comfortably commit
yeah.
to.
Okay. We understand.
Okay.
Yep.
Vanessa had a question.
I have a hypothetical. If FinCom decides not to recommend the 438, if town meeting does not vote, or if FinCom does, but town meeting does not approve the 438, will we lose those 7 positions?
The school committee heard the reductions that we made as our recommendation to get to the balanced budget in January.
And not a single one of us could come up with
yeah.
better cuts.
So, the answer is most
probably.
Likely, yeah.
I think that's why Bob sort of put it out front, is to make it clear that we're going to support keeping these 7 teachers, and we'll figure out a way to make that happen. And I think he did that up front so that it was a very sensitive issue, so that teachers could feel comfortable. We will come up with a way to make that
happen. I don't think he said that. I think he said that the school committee will work a little harder to try to find it, and the town side will do what they can to enable that to happen.
That's a way to make it happen.
I just wanted to add on to this discussion that's going on and what Jean had said to spread that net a little wider, because when the town manager and the selectman recognized the issue, and when we stuck our necks out for the sake of the schools, which is our job, the town manager worked really hard to come up with this cogent plan forward. And like you were saying, Paula and Paul, the they agreed that this wasn't, they weren't the right cuts to make. And so in their plan,
they were very supportive as well. And so I wanted to say thank you. It was a very inspiring meeting with the finance committee, and it also was a very reassuring and supportive meeting with the selectmen and the town manager. So I feel like the town has been working really hard to work together for the best interests of the town, the community, and the schools, and the students. And so I just wanted to say thank you for that, because it could have gone a very different way. It could have just been, that's got to be the number, we're not listening to why, but it wasn't at all that. I think everybody's hearts, minds, and fiscal responsibility is on providing the best program that we can for the students and the community. So that's a thank you.
Thank you. Other comments, questions? I would entertain a motion.
Motion to adjourn.
We have a second.
Second.
Second. Those in favor? We are 9-0. We are adjourned. Thank you, folks.
Oh, I need a motion.
I'll make a motion to adjourn to the school committee, please.
Second.
School committee adjourned?
Yeah.
Raise your hand, Mr. Robinson, 4-0.